Matt, nice to see you. Good morning.
Morning.
Let's start with some injury news firstly. And Joel Latibodia, obviously didn't figure last weekend. Will he figure this week?
We're hoping so. Joel's going to be with the team today on the grass, but it will only be his second day on the grass. So we're going to see how he comes through today. But it's hopefully good news that Joel's back involved.
What about some of the other lads who've been out and have been on the fringe? Actually, Liam Walsh, interestingly, because he played last night, didn't he, for the 21s?
He did. Walsh has come back in brilliant shape, but obviously it's very important that we get as many minutes under his belt as possible. He was excellent again last night, played 45 minutes in a very good game, actually. Lads played really well. Some brilliant stuff from there in the 21s, right? He's done a great job there with some of those boys. And obviously Cam Congreve played a full 90 last night, which puts him in a better place than he was previously. So Walshy has come through the game fine, and only playing 45 minutes means that he can be involved with us today and tomorrow.
Joe Allen, how well placed is he to start a game now in the first team?
Joe's improving all the time. Obviously, missed a little bit of time with his last little knock. I think because we've got so many games coming up that Joe's going to play plenty and play his fair share, like all the lads are going to. There's obviously, you know, the squad's not massive. We've got a busy period coming up, and I think there's an opportunity for all the players to get a start amongst those games and really add some value to the team.
And there must be a keenness to perform at home after what has been a difficult run of results at the moment.
Yeah, definitely. I think there's a big opportunity tomorrow to play in front of our home fans and perform really well. I think on the whole, performances have been good. Obviously, the last two results are disappointing. We've had really good spells against Birmingham, a real dominant display for most part. Obviously, Saturday, there's some really good periods in the game and positives to take. So we just need to make sure that we turn those performances into some results and tomorrow night being an opportunity.
Can you still make the playoffs, given everything that's gone on and off the field?
I think there's an 8-game period now between this and the international break. And I think there's an opportunity to get closer and to put performances and turn performances into results. I think everybody's looking forward to this period, this busy period. Obviously, we've got, like I said, lots of games coming up. I think that maybe previously on our good run, previously we won 3 out of 4 games and that gets you back in the mix. And so we need to make sure the performances are at the level that they had been against the Watfords, the Burnleys, the QPR, the Sunderland game, that run of 4 games that were good performances in there. We just need to make sure that we perform at the same level and maybe avoid those moments in games that we've given away goals when perhaps we've been on top or the opposition haven't had to do loads to maybe score against us. So we just need to sort of clean up those moments in games and I think the dominance will then turn into results.
We remember you and the other coaches showing a united front on Russell's press conference a few weeks back after the disappointing transfer window. Does that show a togetherness in the camp, not just with the coaches, but with everyone at the club?
I think so. I hope so. I think that we are a very close-knit bunch, staff and players. I think that the staff are very grateful for how much courage and bravery the players show. I think it's reciprocated by the players to the staff that we show them loads of care. We're always trying to help them, always trying to improve individuals that will then hopefully improve the team. So there is a real togetherness up here at the training ground, and I think that's really got an opportunity to show in the latter periods of this season.
The transfer issue has gone now, but Russell did admit that he was very low at one point. As someone who knows him very well, as his assistant, and all the coaches, did you see it as part of your job to try and pick him up specifically?
Yes, I think that we're all a little bit disappointed with how the window turned out. But there's disappointments in football all the time, whether it's during a game, after a game, during a transfer window. And there's not particularly too much time for disappointment in football. You need to to move on quickly. Russ is unbelievably resilient, like I think we all are. Of course, it's our jobs, my job to support him. There's a clue in the title to assist him. And hopefully we do that as staff. Myself, Dino, Chris, sports science staff, Rhys and Matt, even Ben, the analyst. We're very a tight bunch, and we're I think it can be a lonely job being a head coach. I think however much support you've got, you're the one that steps out here in front of you guys, the one in the technical area, the one that maybe takes the flak. I think that it can be a lonely job, and I think it's really important that we show our support, and we're really grateful for how the gaffer treats us. And hopefully we repay that with some support during the tough moments.
Because he's very much a mentor to you, isn't he? Because I mean, obviously you're his assistant, but we see you a lot in press conferences. You're learning a lot from him, I'd imagine.
Oh, without a shadow of a doubt, I think I've learned I don't want to be a head coach. No, I think it's we're obviously very close. We're friends, but I think it's really important that I support him in the tough moments. He supported me. I think the reason I enter some of the press conferences is to show that support and that he's not on his own. Because I think, like I've mentioned before, I've worked for previous managers and they mention about the loneliness of the job. I think sometimes as an assistant, I can maybe do a Homer Simpson and go back into the dugout where he perhaps has to stand up and face it all. So I think it's important that all the staff are together and show the support for him because of what he's done for us as well.
Ultimately, everyone gets judged on results, and it is 2 wins in 16 now. At what point do you get concerned about that run?
We're always reflecting on games, previous games, results, and the way we work, with the process we work, is always trying to get better. Obviously, there's been some disappointing results, but performance-wise, like I mentioned, that period of coming into the new year, the Watford game, the Burnley game, going away to Sunderland, the point away from QPR and a real dominant display. So we just need to make sure we turn some of the draws into wins. And obviously we're working as hard as we possibly can to do that at the moment. And we're all together in trying to do that.
Regardless of Blackpool's league position at the moment, that old line gets dragged out. Anyone can beat anyone in the championship. But it's true when you look at results from week to week.
Yeah, it's obviously a mental league, isn't it? It will be a tough game. I know it's a bit of a cliche, but it will be a tough game. They're fighting for their lives. Obviously, got a really experienced manager come in now with Mick. Really experienced, good guy, Terry Connor, his assistant. So it'll be a tough game. But we know the onus is on us. We're at home. It's about how we perform and making sure that's a dominant performance.
Has Mick got enough to keep Blackpool up, do you think? It's difficult to say, I know, because the fight for the lives down there.
Yeah, that'll probably be a question for Mick. but yeah, I think that the league's how it is anyone that puts a run together can get themselves out of trouble or get themselves from mid-table to into the playoff mix. So I think the league, how it is, if anyone puts a run together at the right time, it can be really positive for the club.
And Neil Warnock's back at 74, showing that age is no barrier in football management.
unbelievable, really. I had a few friends that have played for him in the past and love working under him, so I'm sure he'll try and galvanise that club. I've seen a few photos yesterday of his first period there, so him and Ronnie Jepson. So I think, it's interesting for the league. I'm sure the media guys will lap it up and... we'll see how they do.
Matt, thanks very much indeed.
No worries.
Morning, Matt. Good to see you.
Morning, mate.
You mentioned the defensive side of things. I think Saturday kind of highlighted that, the first and third goals in particular. The manager mentioned it. It's proving costly at the moment. $1 million question, I'm sure. But, I mean, how do you go about eradicating that? Because it keeps happening and it's proving so costly, isn't it?
It is. We're obviously trying to learn from everything we do, whether that's in possession, out of possession. Obviously, we started the game really well. And it's just periods in games where the opposition maybe don't have to do loads to create a chance. I think that chance creation against us, we're probably in the top 6 or 7 in the league about giving chances at goal and our own goal. Expected goals against is pretty decent in the league. So we need to make sure the chance we do give up are not good chances, but also those moments that may lead to goals. I think there's some, I think it might have been shown on Saturday, that a really experienced team making fouls at the right time, making fouls in the right areas. And that's something that we need to improve. We need to get better at managing games in periods in games when there might be danger. But like the gaffer says, we are one of the youngest teams in the league. I think 5 out of the 10 youngest teams this year have been us in the Championship. So the lads need to learn. They need to learn quickly. But it can only help going through tough times, making mistakes, losing goals. I think we work in a way where we're always trying to learn from every situation, and that needs to be the same with the goals we're conceding.
How big a learning curve is this league? You look at Nathan Wood, so young in his first season here, Harry Darling coming up from League One as well. They're, you know, young centre-backs, and if you're making mistakes there, like you say, they're the ones that are costly, but they are the young lads who've only come here in the summer.
That's right, and they're only going to get better. They're going to have tremendous careers ahead of them. Those young players you mentioned, all the young players we've got in the team are going to have tremendous careers ahead of them. And I think, I would like to think that we work in a way where they feel really supported. They're helped through the tough periods. I know the manager spends a lot of time with the defenders, for example. So it's supporting all the players through the tough periods, but they're learning. There's an unbelievable opportunity here for them to play regularly, to learn from mistakes and only get better and better.
You touched on rotation at the beginning, 3 games in 7 days now. It's not ideal when your squad is quite thin and you've had a couple of knocks here and there, but how difficult is it to rotate when you don't have the depth that you would have wanted?
It's tough. The squad's thinner than my wig, some people may say. It's having a really close-knit group can be good. I think in training you'll see that everybody knows that they're very close to starting a game because the squad's made up like that. So everybody needs to be ready. Everybody gets the detail that they need. There's never a sort of a starting 11 and the rest of the boys are left to their own devices. That everyone gets the detail they'll need to make an impact on the pitch. And they are all ready to make an impact. So there will be changes within that period of games because they'll need to be with so many games in a short space of time, but that's no different to how it's been all season. I think that the 16, 17, 18 players, outfield players that we've got are all ready to add value to their teammates once they're on the pitch.
And in the fallout from the window, the manager spoke about the contract situations of, you know, Ryan Manning, Joel Latabodier, there's a few others as well. How important is it that they get tied down now? Because let's say you can't be losing another few key players in the summer when your squad's where it is already?
No, obviously the summer window is totally different. So that will look after itself. Once we get to the summer, it will look after itself. I think that it is important. I'm sure Josh and Julian are trying their hardest to tie stuff down, tie players down. But at the moment, I think that you'll see that lads are concentrating on doing the best they possibly can for the team. And that's all we ask of the lads that are out of contract, really. And they've given us that all season. And I'd imagine they'll give us it until the end of the season.
Yeah, and just lastly from me, Russ mentioned the goalkeeper situation last week as well, that the free agent market was being looked at, and Dean Thornton, who's sat behind us here today, was looking at that. Is there any development in that? And does there come a point where that's no longer an option? You stick with Andy Fisher and Lewis Webb?
There's always scope. Obviously, Dean works extremely hard with the keepers and will always look at options. I think if you're not succession planning, then you're a little bit behind the curve. So we'll always be prepared for certain situations. So we'll just continue to be prepared in case anything changes.
Thanks very much.
No worries.